Hello students, we were discussing about the fourth chapter, that is structure of atom. In the previous lecture we have discussed the isotopes, isopars and isotones. In case of isotopes, we have studied that these are the atoms, different atoms of same element having same atomic number and different mass number. That is, the isotopes possess same number of protons but different number of neutrons. Now again we have seen how to determine the atomic mass of the atoms. We have seen that the atomic mass is nothing but the summation of number of protons present in the nucleus and number of neutrons present in it. On the basis of this simple formula, we have calculated the atomic mass of that of some atoms. Now, the isotopes are having the different atomic masses. We have seen. Again, let's see the example of chlorine. The chlorine atom has two isotopes. Its atomic number is 17 and the mass number is 35. One more isotope of chlorine is having the mass number, that is 37. Now, if such is the case, you know that the atoms like hydrogen, nitrogen, carbon, oxygen, they are having the different isotopes. Now, all the isotopes are coexisting with each other, but their natural abundance is fixed. The ratio of their abundance in nature is always fixed, means they have a definite percentage in nature. Now here these two isotopes of chlorine are also having a fixed ratio, which is given as 3:1. Then how will you determine the exact or accurate atomic mass of these isotopes? In the first chapter, that is some basic concepts of chemistry, you have studied how the atomic mass is determined for the isotopes. And in that chapter, you have studied that atomic mass is nothing but the average atomic mass. And that atomic mass depends upon the percentage abundance of the various isotopes and their mass numbers. Now here we will also determine the average atomic mass of chlorine. How it is determined? Let's see. Here the ratio of their abundance in nature is given. Natural abundance is given, that is 3:1. What it indicates? It indicates that out of 4 chlorine atoms, 3 chlorine atoms are having the atomic mass 35, while only 1 chlorine atom is having the atomic mass 37. So, on this basis of information, you can easily find the average atomic mass. For that purpose, what you are doing? You are taking the average of their atomic masses along with their abundance. Let's see how it is determined. We know that the chlorine atom, whose atomic mass is 35, it is having only 3 out of 4. 3 atoms are having mass 35, while the one atom is having atomic mass 37. So while taking the average, here you have to multiply the mass of that atom with its abundance, make a summation of mass of another atom with its abundance and divide it by the total number of atoms. If you do this calculation, simple calculation, you will get the final answer as 35.5. So this is the average atomic mass of chlorine atom. In this way, you can easily find the average atomic masses of the atoms which are existing as the isotopes. and the details about this you have already studied in the first chapter. Okay, now today we will see the drawbacks of Rutherford's atomic model. Standard, you have studied the Rutherford's alpha particle scattering experiment. What was that experiment? I will just revise it. Rutherford has striked a beam of alpha particles on a very thin gold foil. He has used the alpha particle source, which was kept in a lead block. Suppose this is a source of alpha particles, one of the radioactive element. The alpha particles are radiated by this source, and these alpha particles are passed through a thin slit, lead slit. Okay. So that we get a fine beam. Now this beam of alpha particles was striped on a very thin gold foil. This foil was surrounded by the ZnS screen, zinc sulfide screen. This is a gold foil, very thin gold foil. Its diameter is about 100 nanometer. Now he has made some observations in his experiment when these alpha particles were passed or allowed to strike on this gold foil. What was the observations? What were the observations? See, so he has observed that so many particles have been passed through this gold foil, while very few alpha particles were deflected in certain angle and striked on the ZnS screen. Very few, almost one of the alpha particle from lakhs of the alpha particles have been deflected back through an angle of 180. Okay, some alpha particles were deflected through an angle which is less than 90 degree, like this. And most of the alpha particles were passed through this slit or gold foil in a straight line direction. And on the basis of this experiment or observations of this experiment, he has made some conclusions. Now, why these alpha particles were passed in a straight line? Most of the alpha particles were passed through this gold foil in a straight line. He has concluded that there must be a hollow space in the nucleus of the in the atoms of this gold foil. Suppose these are the atoms of the gold foil. Then, since so many alpha particles have been passed through this in a straight line, he has concluded that most of the space in that atom should be empty. There should be a hollow space or empty space in the atom. Again, on the basis of second observation, he has made another conclusion. In the second observation, he has observed that some of the alpha particles were deflected through an angle less than 90 degree. And on the basis of this observation, again he has concluded that at the center of these atoms, there must be a positive charge. And that positive charge should be concentrated in a very small space. Why? Because we know that the alpha particles are nothing but the helium nuclei which are having the protons at their in their nucleus. The protons are positively charged. Since some of the particles were deflected, here that alpha particle should be passed near the nucleus, and therefore there will be repulsion between positive charges in the alpha particles and positive charge in the nucleus of these gold atoms, and therefore some of the alpha particles were deflected through a small angle. So some of the very few alpha particles were deflected back. They have returned back through 180 degree. This indicates that the atom must possess a very small sized nucleus which is having a positive charge. Okay, and hence he has given us the new model to describe the structure of atom that was named as Rutherford's atomic model. Now, you know this Rutherford's atomic model. Here, according to this model, the atom consists of nucleus at the center, and this nucleus consists of positively charged protons. Again, Rutherford has told that the mass of atom is concentrated in the nucleus. Okay, and according to Bohr's atomic model, the electrons are revolving in circular orbits. Here, these are the orbits in which the electrons are revolving. He has told us that the diameter of the nucleus is very small as compared to the diameter of the atom, and the remaining portion of the atom is a hollow space, and that's why the alpha particle have been passed through this empty space directly. Okay, now this was the structure. Again, he has told that the atom as a whole is neutral. Why it is neutral? Because the number of positive charges, that is protons, present in the nucleus is equal to the number of electrons revolving around it. You know these features of the Bohr's atomic model. Though this model was given by Bohr, again there were some problems created by this model. There are some drawbacks of this model. So we will see the drawbacks of this model. You know, this model is just like our solar system. It is a thin miniature of solar system. We know in the solar system, sun is at the center, while the planets are revolving continuously around the sun. In the same manner, here the nucleus of an atom is at the center, which is representing the role of sun. While the electrons revolving around this nucleus are representing or playing the role of planets in the solar system. Here, though the electrons are revolving around the nucleus continuously, that electrons have been posed again a problem. Since these electrons are revolving, that electrons must have the orbital motion, right? The electrons are continuously changing their velocity, and therefore they get accelerated. So the electrons are the accelerated charged particles. These electrons are having negative charge, that is, electrons are accelerated negatively charged particles. Okay. Now, according to Maxwell's theory. Maxwell's theory of electromagnetic radiation. Whenever any accelerated charged body or particle revolves, it continuously emits the radiations. Here, since these electrons are accelerated negatively charged particles, they should also emit the radiations, and that is, they should emit the energy. Paha, kaya sahitla Maxwell theory na? Charged particle, kontehi asti, jarte accelerated motion tencha madhe ase, tar ashe particles, jeva move hot astar, teva continuously energy किंवा रेडिएशन्स इमिट करत असतात. दे गिव आउट द एनर्जी. आता हे इलेक्ट्रॉन्स चार्ज पार्टिकल आहे, त्यांना ॲक्सिलरेटेड मोशन आहे, आणि त्यामुळे हे इलेक्ट्रॉन्स काय करतील, जेव्हा ते मूव होणार आहेत, जेव्हा त्यांच्यामध्ये ऑर्बिटल मोशन असणार आहे, तेव्हा ते कंटिन्युअसली एनर्जी इमिट करतील, रेडिएशन्स इमिट करतील. असं जर झालं तर काय होईल, हळूहळू या इलेक्ट्रॉनची एनर्जी डिक्रीज होत जाईल, आणि त्यामुळं हे इलेक्ट्रॉन्स न्यूक्लियसच्या क्लोज यायला लागतील. ॲक्च्युली हा न्यूक्लियस आणि इलेक्ट्रॉन्स यांच्यामध्ये इलेक्ट्रोस्टॅटिक फोर्स ऑफ अट्रॅक्शन असतो. आता जेव्हा हे इलेक्ट्रॉन्स एनर्जी इमिट करायला सुरुवात होईल, तेव्हा ते इलेक्ट्रॉन्स या पद्धतीनं स्पायरल पाथ फॉलो करतील, आणि एका ठराविक स्टेजला त्यांची एनर्जी काय होईल, झिरो होईल. आणि असं जर झालं तर हे इलेक्ट्रॉन या न्यूक्लियसमध्ये येऊन पडतील. दॅट इलेक्ट्रॉन्स विल फॉलो द स्पायरल पाथ अँड दे विल फॉल इन टू द न्यूक्लियस. आणि असं जर झालं तर हा ॲटम स्टेबल राहील का? नाही. विदिन अ फ्रॅक्शन ऑफ सेकंड हा ॲटम नष्ट होणार आहे. पण आपण पाहतो की ॲटम्स आर नॉट अनस्टेबल बट दे आर स्टेबल. सगळे ॲटम्स हे नेहमी स्टेबल असतात. मग हे जे रुदरफोर्डने सांगितलं की इलेक्ट्रॉन्स आर रिव्हॉल्विंग इन सर्क्युलर ऑर्बिट, बट वाय दे आर नॉट फॉलिंग इन द न्यूक्लियस, वाय दे आर नॉट फॉलोइंग द स्पायरल पाथ, हे मात्र रुदरफोर्ड एक्सप्लेन करू शकला नाही. म्हणजेच काय की ॲटमची स्टॅबिलिटी रुदरफोर्ड एक्सप्लेन करू शकला नाही. दिस वॉज वन ऑफ द इम्पॉर्टंट ड्रॉबॅक गिवन बाय रुदरफोर्ड. ओके, वन मोर ड्रॉबॅक हॅव बीन गिवन. द फर्स्ट ड्रॉबॅक, दॅट इज स्टॅबिलिटी ऑफ ॲटम इज नॉट डिस्क्राइब बाय द रुदरफोर्ड. या इलेक्ट्रॉनची एनर्जी किती असते हे देखील रुदरफोर्ड आपल्या ॲटॉमिक मॉडेलमध्ये डिस्क्राईब करू शकला नाही. याबरोबरच या इलेक्ट्रॉन्सचं डिस्ट्रीब्युशन हे ऑर्बिटमध्ये कशा पद्धतीनं झालेलं असतंय हे देखील रुदरफोर्ड एक्सप्लेन करू शकला नाही. मीन्स ही हॅज अनेबल टू डिस्क्राईब द energy and distribution of electrons. Energy and distribution of electrons is also not described by the Rutherford's atomic model, and therefore different scientists have again made the different attempts to explain the exact or accurate structure of atom. Out of so many scientists, Niels Bohr was one of the scientists He has made the good explanation of the structure of atom. And nowadays we are using the Bohr's atomic model to explain the structure of atom. We will see that Bohr's atomic model later on, but before that, how he has made that atomic model, we will see. For that purpose, he has made the study of interactions of matter with the interactions of radiations with matter. Let's see the developments regarding the Bohr's atomic model. What Bohr has done? He has made the study of interactions of radiations with matter. एखाद्या मॅटर बरोबर इलेक्ट्रोमॅग्नेटिक रॅडिएशन्स कसे इंटरॅक्ट होतात याचा स्टडी बोर्सनं केला सुरुवातीला. ठीक आहे, या हा स्टडी करत असताना त्यांना दोन रिझल्ट महत्त्वाचे तयार केले. पहिला म्हणजे वेल पार्टिकल ड्युअलिटी. Of electromagnetic radiation. आणि दुसरा रिझल्ट होता तो म्हणजे द लाईन इमिशन स्पेक्ट्रा. ऑफ हायड्रोजन इलेक्ट्रोमॅग्नेटिक रॅडिएशन म्हणजे काय? थोडक्यात लाईट एनर्जी किंवा लाईट रॅडिएशन्स. वी नो दॅट द सन इज कंटिन्युअसली इमिटिंग द लाईट. ठीक आहे, ही लाईट आहे त्या लाईट रॅडिएशनलाच आपण इलेक्ट्रोमॅग्नेटिक रॅडिएशन असं म्हणतो. का? तर लाईट इज मेडअप ऑफ टू कंपोनंट्स. वन इज द इलेक्ट्रिक कंपोनंट अँड द अदर वन इज द मॅग्नेटिक कंपोनंट. अँड दॅट्स वाय दॅट लाईट radiation or light rays are also called as electromagnetic radiations. आता हे रॅडिएशनचं नेचर कसं असणार आहे हे बोर्सनी अगोदर सांगितलं. यामध्ये त्यांना सांगितलं की दॅट रॅडिएशन्स आर हॅविंग अ वेव नेचर. दॅट रॅडिएशन्स आर जस्ट लाईक अ वेव. अगेन ही हॅज टोल्ड अस दॅट द रॅडिएशन्स आर जस्ट लाईक अ पार्टिकल. So there is a duality regarding the nature of radiations. Radiations हे एकाच पद्धतीनं आपण एक्सप्लेन करू शकत नाही, आयदर ॲज अ वेव ऑर ॲज अ पार्टिकल. रॅडिएशन्स आर हॅविंग द ड्युअल बिहेवियर. दे आर बिहेविंग लाईक अ वेव अँड दे आर ऑल्सो बिहेविंग लाईक अ पार्टिकल. हे त्यानं का सांगितलं? कारण काही फिनॉमिनॉन असेल, फॉर एक्झाम्पल डिफ्रॅक्शन ऑर इंटरफेरन्स ऑफ लाईट, हे फिनॉमिनॉन जर एक्सप्लेन करायचे असतील तर तुम्हाला त्या रॅडिएशनचं वेव नेचर विचारात घ्यावं लागतं. डिफ्रॅक्शन अँड इंटरफेरन्स ऑफ लाईट. दीज टू फिनॉमिनॉन वी आर एक्सप्लेन विथ द हेल्प ऑफ वेव नेचर ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोमॅग्नेटिक रॅडिएशन्स. व्हाईल the particle nature of radiation explains the phenomenon like photoelectric effect. आता जर तुम्हाला photoelectric effect किंवा black body radiation यासारखे phenomenon explain करायचे असतील तर मात्र त्या radiation विचारात घेऊन चालणार नाही, त्यावेळी तुम्हाला पार्टिकल नेचरच विचारात घ्यावं लागतं. सो दिस वेव पार्टिकल ड्युअलिटी हॅज बीन गिव्हन बाय बोर्स ॲटॉमिक मॉडेल. अगेन ही आज स्टडी द लाईन इमिशन स्पेक्ट्रा ऑफ हायड्रोजन. नाऊ वॉट आर द कॅरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ इलेक्ट्रोमॅग्नेटिक रॅडिएशन्स, हाऊ इट बिहेव्स जस्ट लाईक अ वेव ऑर जस्ट लाईक अ पार्टिकल, अँड वॉट इज मीन बाय द लाईन इमिशन स्पेक्ट्रा ऑफ हायड्रोजन, दॅट पार्ट वी विल स्टडी इन द नेक्स्ट लेक्चर. ओके, थँक्यू.